You are listening to a sermon by Pastor Christopher Sally of New Life Christian Fellowship Church.
From weakling to warrior. Amen. You may have your seats. We're going to talk a little bit about from weakling to warrior. And you didn't know your president's name was in the Bible, did you? Yeah, you didn't, did you? I didn't appreciate that. Amen, because all the time I was growing up, it wasn't Barack, it was Barack. But it ain't Barack no more. I don't care if it's not right. It's Barack. Amen. Amen. I'm excited today to talk a little bit about the judge Gideon. Amen. And I'm really excited because here we have another opportunity to look at someone's life and see it as it progresses. Amen. Because most times, most people don't come fully formed, amen, and their faith walk and their relationship with God goes and grows in stages, amen. And I'm pretty sure that's probably your experience as well, amen. There's not all of the times that God spoke to you and you responded, you did everything you were supposed to do, you did it perfectly, and that's your story. And if that's your story and you're sticking to it, God bless you. That's not my story. My story is a story of ups and downs and ins and outs and turns and twists, and it's not been one straight line on the pathway of faith. Amen? It hasn't been a straight journey right up the mountain. Sometimes you start in a certain place and God meets you where you are and brings you where you need to be. And so I want you to turn in your Bibles to Judges chapter 6, and we're going to spend a little time together looking at the life of Gideon. It's going to be more of an overview. I would encourage you to look at it as a little bit more closely, but there's a mention that he has, that the writer of Hebrews says, what more shall I say? Here's some other folks. I'm just going to throw these names out, but these folks are deemed faithful. So it's incumbent upon us to discover why they were called faithful, especially when you hear a title like From Weakling to Warrior, which means he didn't really start out as the man. Amen. So I want you to say that Gideon did not go, and this is what I really love about this story. Gideon did not go looking for God, but God sought him out. Amen? Gideon did not go looking for God, and I want you to remember this as well. Gideon was not qualified for the call, but God qualified him to the call. Amen. Gideon was not qualified for the call, but God qualified him to the call. Again, God met him where he was, and he brought him where he needed to be. That, beloved, is a good working definition of discipleship. That's what we should be doing in all of our lives and all of our interactions. You meet somebody where they are, and you bring them where they need to be. In Judges chapter 6, it says, and the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. For 7 years he gave them into the hands of the Midianites. Because the power of Midian was so oppressive, the Israelites prepared shelters for themselves in mountains and clefts and caves and strongholds. Whenever the Israelites planted their crops, the Midianites and the Amalekites and other eastern peoples invaded the country. They camped on the land and ruined the crops all the way to Gaza and did not spare a living thing from Israel, neither sheep nor cattle nor donkeys. They came up with their livestock and their tents like swarms of locusts. It was impossible to count the men and their camels. They invaded the land to ravage it. Midian so impoverished the Israelites that they cried out to the Lord for help. It sounds to me like that's what? Troubled times. Amen. You and I have seen troubled times. We see troubled times right now in most of our Chicago neighborhoods, where you could literally have that same description, that there are people that are roving about in those neighborhoods that are like swarms of locusts, taking what they shouldn't take and doing things that they shouldn't do. But here you see Israel. The first thing is that Israel did evil, though, in the sight of the Lord. Amen. And so literally they had trouble, but they had trouble because of trespass. Amen. And there's a different response. You usually you will find trouble is either you get trouble because of trespass, truth, trial, or training. Amen. You remember that. And if it's from truth, trial, or training, the response is always to remain, because that comes from God. God's trying to do something. But if your trespass is from trouble, you don't remain, you repent. Amen. And that was one thing. If you look at Judges, if you look at the pattern that would happen over and over and over again, you look in Judges chapter 2, the scripture says that there was this disobedience would come, and then this defeat would come. And it was always this kind of rebellion. And then the Lord would get their attention, but you never really say anything about them repenting. It says in verse 10 of Judges 2, after the whole generation had been gathered, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord and served the Baals. They forsook the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them up out of Egypt. They followed and worshiped various gods of the people around him, and they provoked the Lord God to anger. And verse 16 says, then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hands of the raiders. Yet they would not listen to their judges, but prostituted themselves to other gods and worshiped them. And verse 19 says, but when the judge died, the people returned to the ways even more corrupt than those of their fathers, following other gods and serving and worshiping them. They refused to give up their evil practices and stubborn ways. And so that's trouble. We saw trouble before. We saw trouble in Exodus. We saw trouble in the time of Moses, and there was a response to that. We said the faith you need for troubled times. We talked about foundational faith and fearless faith and firm faith and forward faith and a focused faith and a fundamental faith, and we talked about that. It was exhibited by Moses, and it was exhibited by his parents. That's the faith you need for troubled times. That's what you would hope to see in Judges chapter 6 when God rolls up on Gideon, but he did not demonstrate that kind of faith, because Gideon is more like we are. He didn't get it right at first. And so the first thing I need you to know about Gideon is I want to look at Gideon the weakling. Amen. He had what I would describe as woeful faith. Woeful faith. The kind of faith you don't even want to talk about. The kind of faith that you that when it's discussed, you put your head down. It's like, Gideon had little to no faith. It was what I would describe as woeful faith. And so the angel of the Lord in verse 11, and again, you're going to see somebody else's name that you know and love in this verse. The angel of the Lord came and sat down under the oak in Ophrah. Amen. That's where she got her name. Just didn't keep the H in there. She sat down at the oak in Ophrah, and that belonged to Joash the Abiezrite, where his son Gideon was threshing wheat in a wine press to keep it from the Midianites. When the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon, he said, what? The Lord is with you, mighty warrior. I just called Gideon a weakling, but the angel of the Lord called him what? A mighty warrior. The Lord is with you, mighty warrior. And Gideon literally did like this. Who you talking to? Gideon is trying to thresh some wheat for his family on a threshing floor at night. The threshing floor is below ground. He's trying to hide it, because you heard what the chapter said already. The Midianites were coming in like a swarm of locusts, taking everything. Gideon's like, I'm late at night. I'm just trying to get some food and get something prepared for my family. Gideon is weak in his faith. Gideon is woeful in his faith. But here is God saying to him, listen, I see you. The Lord is what? With you, mighty warrior. But sir, verse 13, Gideon replied, and this is a problem already, because listen to what Gideon has all kind of stuff in this. He says, if, he says, how, he says, when, he says, where, all of those kind of things are part of what Gideon says. He says, if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are all the wonders that our fathers told us about when they said, did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? But now the Lord has abandoned us and put us in the hand of Midian. Gideon is in what I would describe as the slap zone. Gideon is squarely in the slap zone. Why? Because he has woeful faith. You know how you can tell woeful faith? Because it's filled with two things, doubt and distortion. Doubt about what God has already said and distortion about the circumstances and how you got in them. Doubt and distortion is why Gideon had woeful faith. That's why he was weak. God said, the angel of the Lord said, the Lord is with you, who? Mighty warrior. And he says, if God is with us, you question what God said. Amen. Even if the circumstances don't line up with the truth of God, you hang with the truth of God till your circumstances change. That's how you have real faith. That's a faith that sees beyond seeing. Amen. That's a faith that sees with spiritual eyes. If God declares it, it's true. And you have to stick with what God says regardless until the circumstances change to line up with the truth that God has revealed. And Gideon had woeful faith because it was filled with doubt. And the second thing it was filled with distortion because he says, God has done what? Abandoned us. Not a chance. You abandoned God. God did not abandon you. In this particular instance, you are in this trouble because you have dealt with trespass. You left God. God said, I'm here, but you've went whoring after other gods. You've done these things. And you know what? The reason why you have to have a true picture of why you got someplace, because if you don't have a true picture of how you got into your circumstances, you won't have a true path on how to get out. I already told you, if your trouble is from truth, trial, or training, you need to remain because God has you there. But if it's from trespass, you need to repent. And that was the thing that was missing in that whole cycle of over and over with the judges and what God did with the children of Israel. They never repented. God just gave them relief. But as soon as they got relief and a judge died, they went right back and got even what? Worse, the scripture says. Distortion. And doubt leads to woeful faith. And that's why Gideon was a weakling. And even as they continue in their conversation, you might think that Gideon has some humility. Because he says to him in verse 14, the Lord said to him, go in the strength that you have and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you? But Lord, Gideon asked, how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family. He said, I am the least of the least of the least of the least. That sounds like humility. You might think that even sounds a little bit like Moses when Moses says, "Who here am I?" But then when the plan of God was revealed, he said, who am I? That's perfect. That's humility. You might think when Isaiah saw God high and lifted up and he says, woe is me. I'm a man of unclean lips and I dwell amongst a people of unclean lips. That's real humility. What Gideon is tapping into is really not humility, it's pity. Gideon is hosting the biggest pity party in Scripture. Amen. I'm the least of the least of the least. I'm nothing. My people are nothing. You've left us. We don't have anything. We've got all of this trouble. However, you have to understand this. You are who God says you are. Amen. You are who God says you are. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. You have to understand you are who God says you are, and you cling to the truth of God, even if it doesn't line up with your circumstances, and you cling to that truth until your circumstances change. So Gideon the weakling, he had what I would describe as woeful faith, but praise God, he didn't stop there. You start in verse 16, and you will find that we will move on, and you'll see verses 16 through 24, Gideon the worshiper. And he has what I would describe as waking faith. Gideon gets woke. Amen? Gideon is woke now. If you look at verses 16 through 24, he says, I will be with you. I'll strike down all of the Midianites. And Gideon says, if I've found favor in your eyes, let me give me a sign. That's going to be a problem for him later. But give me a sign. Don't go away. Let me make an offering before you. And he does this offering. And you get down to verse 20, and he says, take the meat and then put it on this rock. And he took the tip of the staff in verse 21, and the angel of the Lord touched the meat and the unleavened bread, and fire flamed from the rock, consuming the meat and the bread, and the angel of the Lord disappeared. And when Gideon realized that it was the angel of the Lord, he said, ah, sovereign Lord, I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face. But the Lord said to him, woo, peace. Do not be afraid. You are not going to die. So Gideon built an altar to the Lord there and called it the Lord is peace. What is that? Jehovah Shalom. In the midst of trouble. Come on, somebody. In the midst of trouble, God revealed himself as peace. In the midst of trouble, God revealed himself as peace. And when he did that, Gideon worshiped. That's why he built an altar. He says, I'm going to call this place, I'm going to call this altar, the Lord is peace. He has revealed that he is peace. He's revealed my favor to me in verse 12. He says, you are a mighty warrior. And he's removed my fear by saying, I'm telling you, peace, don't be afraid. Those are two very important things that you have to remember. God often will show up in the middle of your troubled circumstances, even if you have caused the trouble yourself. And God will reveal himself as peace. Don't be afraid. I got you. I got you. Just worship. The Lord is what? Peace. He revealed Gideon's favor in verse 12, and he removed his fear in verse 23. And then I love this. He didn't just stop there. He rebukes his flesh. Because you and I both know that peace is born out of reconciliation. You say, well, where's the sick reconciliation? If God has declared peace, the reconciliation comes when he tells Gideon in verses 25 and 26, that same night the Lord said to him, take the second bull from your father's herd and one of the seven years, tear down your father's altar to Baal and cut down the Asherah pole besides it. Then build a proper kind of altar to the Lord your God on the top of this height. The reconciliation comes when we said there can be no division in your worship. I need you now to rebuke your flesh. You need to tear down that altar that's in your pop's house, the Baal altar and the Asherah pole. You got to tear that down, because if I'm going to reveal myself as peace and you're going to worship me, you can worship me and nobody else. You have to be reconciled to me and me alone. And he rebuked his flesh, and Gideon went through a little bit of a issue around that. He tore it down, but he did it at night because he was scared. But by the end of the chapter, he also, you see, the Lord rekindles his flame in verse 34, because Gideon now says, the scripture says, then the spirit of the Lord came upon Gideon and he blew a trumpet, summoning the Abizarites to follow him. Gideon again is now woke, because Gideon is a worshiper. Gideon moves from Gideon the weakling to Gideon the what? Worshiper. He moves from woeful faith to waking faith. But then, before the chapter is over, and this is what I love so much about Gideon, it's a little bit of up and down with him. And you know why I love that? Because it's a little bit of up and down with you. It's a little bit of up and down with me. You would think, okay, Gideon's off. He's got his wings. He's gone now. He gets it. The Lord's revealed himself as the Lord is peace. He saw the angel of the Lord face to face. These are all very powerful things. But Gideon moves from weakling to again being the worshiper. But now it's also, you have to understand, Gideon the worrier. Gideon the worrier. He has what I would describe as wavering faith. Wavering faith. Gideon said to God, if you will save Israel by my hand, as you have promised, if you will, then what? I'm going to place this fleece on the threshing floor. If it's dew on the fleece and all on the ground and the ground is dry, then I will know that you will save Israel by my hand. And that's exactly what happened. Gideon said in verse 39, don't be mad at me, Lord. One more test. This time make this brother is, again, this is all slap zone territory as far as the God I know. This time, make the fleece dry and the ground covered with dew. That night, God did so. Only fleece was dry. All the ground was covered with dew. So, okay, this is, now you would say, well, it was successful. He put the Lord to the test, and the Lord did what he said. But let me warn you about this. You do not want to have a pattern, beloved, where you say, if this is true, God, then do that. That's not a pattern that you want. You know where you see that pattern? You see that pattern in Matthew chapter 4. You know who served up that pattern? The devil, when he was tempting Jesus. He says, then he took him and he says, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. If you are the Son of God, you can throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift up their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. And Jesus answered him, quoting Deuteronomy chapter 6, it is also written, do not put your Lord your God to the test. You don't test God. God tests you. Amen? You don't test God. It's nothing wrong with saying, Lord, I'm scared. Lord, I don't understand. Lord, please reveal yourself to me. Lord, help me to see something. That's different. But that phrasing, that kind of challenge, if what you said is true, if you really did it as you promised, then I need you to do this. No. If I said it, it's real. If I said it, it's true. If I said it, you can take it to the bank. You don't test God. God tests you. And so the fact that he put out the fleece has everything to do with God's grace. Where would I be without God's grace? Amen? God gave him grace to say, I'm going to work with him because I'm going to meet you where you are and bring you where you need to be. But as a pattern, as an example, that's not what you and I want to do. Matter of fact, Jesus said this when he was dealing with the Pharisees. The Pharisees and teachers of the law came to him and said, teacher, we want to see a miraculous sign from you. And he answered, a wicked and adulterous generation asked for a miraculous sign, but none will be given except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. That's the only sign I'm going to give you, is the sign of my death, burial, and resurrection. That's all you need. This is not miracles on demand. This is not miracles are us. You don't test me. I test you. Amen? And so Gideon, the who? Warrior. And he was worried. I don't know if this is going to happen. He had just had his first encounter with the public, and they were mad, and they said, whoever tore down the community altar of Baal, we need to bring him out. The word on the street is it's Gideon. And if it's Gideon, bring him out, because we're trying to kill him. So Gideon was, that's a worry. But his pops was like, you got to run up here behind Baal. I mean, if Baal is God, let him deal with Gideon himself. You know, can he police his own altar? And they started calling him Jerubbaal, which means let Baal deal with him. They changed his name. It's like, okay, good point. Yeah, Baal will deal with it. So again, Gideon's worried. And sometimes you and I get worried, amen, when God has told us something and the circumstances have not lined up with the truth of God. The Lord is with you, mighty warrior. Go in the power that I've given you. Have I not what? Sent you. Gideon's got a big task ahead. And that's why he goes from, and I love this, in chapter 7, he goes from Gideon the warrior to Gideon the witness. Because when you begin to move on what God has told you to do, you are a witness to the power and presence and provision of God. And he went from having wavering faith to having willing faith. Willing faith. And so in Judges chapter 7, and you, I believe you know this story, and we're going to move quickly to get to that point. He tells him early in the morning, all his men were camped. The camp of Midian was north of them, and they had 24. He had a whole bunch of folks with him. But the Lord said to Gideon, there are too many men for me to deliver Midian into their hands. In order that Israel may not boast against me that her own strength saved her, announce that now. Anyone who trembles with fear may turn back and leave Mount Gilead. And 22,000 people jetted immediately, and 10,000 remained. So 32 down to 10. And the Lord said to Gideon, it's still too many. So take them down to the water. And he says, if I say this one shall go, he shall go. But I say this one shall not go with you, he shall not go. And he took them down and he separated those who lapped the water with their tongues like a dog versus those who knelt down to drink. And 300 men lapped with their hands and all the rest got down. And he said, yeah, send them away. Now we down to 300, the real 300. Amen. Not the 300 from the movie 300. That took the, in the Battle of Thermopylae, and you know how exciting that was. It was 300 against a Persian army that was basically unnumbered. Yeah, that's how it was again. But we're talking about a biblical 300. We're talking about this story here, how he started out with 32,000 and came all the way down to 300. Gideon was Gideon the witness, and he had willing faith because he did what God told him to do. And here's what I love about God. He says this in verse 8. Now the camp of Midian lay below him in the valley. During the night, the Lord said to Gideon, get up, go down against the camp because I'm going to give it into your hands. If you are afraid to attack, go down to the camp with your servant and listen to what they are saying. Afterward, you will be encouraged to attack the camp. And he went down. And just as he arrived, somebody said, I had a dream. A round loaf of barley came tumbling into Midian the camp. It struck the tent and overturned and collapses. His friend responded, this can be nothing other than the sword of Gideon, son of Joash, the Israelite. God has given the Midianites and the whole camp into his hand. Gideon did not need to put that darn fleece out. God said, I got you. I know you. I know you better than I know yourself. I know you're worried. I know you're scared. And if you need encouragement, I'm going to give it to you. Go down to the camp. That's what God, his instruction. I don't need you to put the fleece out. Don't test me. I'll test you. Go down to the camp. And go down there and listen to what they're saying. And he says, I've had this dream. He said, that can be none other than Gideon, the son of the Gideon, the what? The Midianite. And even gave up his pop's name in it. The son of Joash, the Israelite. No other Gideon that they're talking about. And after that, Gideon was all good. Because God had him. And God knew what he needed, and God knows what you need in your faith journey in order for you to be able to remain and be able to wait until the truth of what God has revealed lines up with the circumstances that you see. And he went from being the Gideon the witness with willing faith to Gideon the warrior with winning faith. Amen. And we know what happened. He went with those 300. And they reached the edge of the camp, and they had those torches, and they had those, and they had the trumpets, and they had the jars. And then it says in verse 21, a sword for the Lord and for Gideon. And while each man held his position, all the Midianites ran, crying out as they fled. And when 300 trumpets sounded, the Lord caused the men through the camp to turn on each other with their swords. That's verse 22. The army fled, and Gideon was triumphant. Gideon the warrior. Amen. And trust me, all warriors are worshipers. In the Bible, you need to be a worshiper first. That's how you become a warrior. You want to tap in, you want to do it right. You want to triumph in the things that God wants you to do. You need to be a worshiper first with waking faith, for you can be a warrior second with what? Winning faith. And I wish that was the end of the story. And it should be the end of the story. And that would be great. Now, how Gideon went from weakling to warrior. But after the triumph, beloved, there's also a trap. And I believe that God allowed us to see this about Gideon so that it would be a warning to us. But that really is why Gideon is mentioned in the Hall of Fame of Faith, if you will, because Gideon was able to go from where he was and going with those ups and downs. And even though he put out the fleece and he was a warrior, he got it together so that he was a worshiper and a witness and a warrior for the kingdom of God. Amen. And so Gideon had winning faith. But after you win, you have to be careful that you do not win the battle and then lose the victory. And Gideon put himself in a place where after that triumph, he didn't watch out for the trap. And you don't want to lose the victory by compromising your relationship with God. And Gideon turned into Gideon the wanderer. Amen. It was Gideon the what? The wanderer, because after his winning faith, he had weakening faith. And in Judges chapter 8, Gideon, the Israelites, verse 22, Israelites says to Gideon, rule over us now, you, your son, and your grandson. Says, we want you to be king because you have saved us. But Gideon told him, I will not rule over you. But here's what I do want you to do. Break me off a piece of some of that gold y'all grabbed, some of that plunder. Give up some of the resources. And for some reason, he did that, and then they answered, we'll be glad to give you, and they spread it all out, and it says it came to 1,700 shekels, about 43 pounds of gold, not counting some other ornaments and pendants and all of that. And Gideon made the gold into an ephod, which was a religious breastplate that the people had as part of what God had designed for the priestly garments, and he made a golden one. And all Israel prostituted themselves by worshiping it there, and it became a snare to Gideon and his family. Some kind of way, after the triumph came the trap. The enemy never stops. You can go from being a weakling to a warrior and think it's over. You think you're on the mountaintop, and at the mountaintop you look over and the enemy will hit you in the head with a golden ephod. Gideon kind of started to compromise his relationship with the one who gained him victory. He built this huge harem. He took all of these resources, and then he also began to step out of his lane. Amen. Because he started to go into that priestly function, and it said they prostituted themselves, worshiping that thing that he had designed, and it became a snare to him and his family. You and I have to be careful that we don't fall into a trap after the triumph. Amen. And the only way you and I can do that is by not having that kind of what I would call wavering, a weakening faith, but that we continue by having working faith. You and I must constantly, we have the victory, but we have to walk in the victory. Amen. We have to have that working faith. We can learn so many lessons from Gideon's life. I love him. I love the fact that he was scared. I love the fact that God was patient with him. I love the fact that God encouraged him. I even love the fact that Gideon shows us what not to do when you in your relationship with God on a couple of instances. Don't test God. Let God test you. Don't worry that God doesn't know how to encourage you. He does. He had the perfect encouragement waiting for Gideon just one chapter later. Don't test God. And you and I have to always know what God reveals as true. What God reveals, is true. And if the truth of God does not line up with your circumstances, you cling to the truth of God until your circumstances change. And have the kind of faith that you and I need to have, which I will call working faith. Father, in the name of